Hello, welcome to Black Horizons. I'm your host, Hamid Rasheed. First in Black Horizons community news, the first item is to take place on Tuesday, October 30th at 8 p.m., a Meet Your District 8 candidate rally night. The meeting will be held at Lake Echo Fire Hall in support of Wayne Adams. Speakers will be Mr. Dave McKean, Don Monroe, John Fortunato, Canadian welterweight champion Clyde Gray, Pastor D.D. Scare. Everyone is welcome. That's Tuesday, October 30th, 8 p.m., Lake Echo Fire Hall. The Victoria Roads Laymen's will hold a supper on November 3rd. On November 2nd to 4th, the National Black Coalition of Canada will hold their conference and general meeting at the Holiday Inn in Halifax. Registration for that conference is $5. We'll be talking more about the conference in our program today. District number 1 services of the African United Baptist Association will be held on Sunday, November 4th, 1979, in St. Thomas Church, North Preston. Services will be at 2:30 and 7 p.m. On November 3rd, the Halifax County elections will be held. We'd like to urge the voters in districts number 8 and districts number 7 to turn out and vote in this very important election. The school board elections will also be held on this particular day, and all voters in districts 7A and 8 are encouraged to support the candidates. November 9th, in the Hotel Nova Scotia in the Commonwealth Room, there'll be a Clyde Gray roast. Clyde Gray, the former Commonwealth champion and present Canadian welterweight champion, will be roasted by a number of dignitaries here in Nova Scotia. The roasters include the Honorable Gerald Regan, former Premier of Nova Scotia, the chap who just won the title from him, Chris Clark, the current Commonwealth champion, Jerry Fogarty, Gail Rice, two of the CFDR sports commentators, former middleweight champion Dave Downey of Halifax, Taylor Gordon, Pat Connolly, George McCurdy, director of the Nova Scotia Human Rights Commission, Wayne Adams, Al Hollingsworth, Harris Sullivan, and his manager Irv Ungerman. Also, as part of the program, the head table guests will include Reverend Donald Scare, the Honorable Roland Thornhill, Canadian heavyweight champion Trevor Berbick, and the mother and father of Clyde Gray, Mr. and Mrs. Tom Gray of Windsor Plains. Bruce Darrington will be the MC for the evening. In addition to the roast, there will also be two amateur boxing events sanctioned by the Nova Scotia branch of the Amateur Boxing Association of Canada. Also on the November 9th, Saturday evening, the East Preston Ratepayers Association, or Recreation Association rather, will have their annual banquet at the East Preston Recreation Center. Individuals requiring more information on this event are encouraged to contact members of the Recreation Association. On Saturday, November 10th, the African United Baptist Association Executive will meet at Victoria Road Baptist Church. From November 11th through to the 14th, the East Preston Baptist Church will be celebrating their 137th anniversary. Finally, a point of information of interest, Mr. Delbert Hodges of Cherry Brook has recently been elected to serve on the trustee board of the Graham Creighton and Sir Robert Borden Junior High Schools. We'd like to pass on a word of sympathy to the family of D.W. Buddy Day. Buddy Day is known to many people in the Halifax-Dartmouth area, has been involved in community affairs for some time. This week was hospitalized for a serious bowel operation. Mr. Day is in hospital at the Halifax Infirmary and is recovering. We'd also like to extend sympathy to those who are mourning the very tragic fire deaths of Don Brooks, age 5, and Lynette Brooks, age 4, in the community of East Preston. That's our Black Horizons community news. If you have items that you would like to have mentioned on the program, we'd encourage you to send your items to Black Horizons Community News, care of Dartmouth Cable TV Station 10, Post Office Box 1011, Dartmouth. In our program today, we're going to be talking to you about the upcoming general meeting and conferences of the National Black Coalition of Canada, which will be held, as we mentioned in the news section, at the Holiday Inn starting on Friday, November 2nd, going through to Sunday, November 4th. We are expecting that approximately 100 delegates will be coming to Halifax at that time from across Canada, from Vancouver through to Nova Scotia, to participate in the conference. We'd like to extend an invitation to all of the interested people in the Halifax-Dartmouth area to come out and participate in the conference at that time. By way of background to the conference, the National Black Coalition of Canada is a national black group which was formed in 1970 to represent the interests of the black community on a national basis. This organization over the years has had its ups and downs until approximately a year ago when a special committee, an interim committee, was established to try to put the National Black Coalition on a solid footing. That committee was comprised of nine individuals from across the country, and they were given the broad mandate of trying to make the organization a viable black organization. People serving on that committee were Roy Williams from Vancouver, Floret Osborne from Regina, Saskatchewan, Dr. Ralph James from Winnipeg, Dr. Howard McCurdy from Windsor, Ontario, Dr. Wilson Hedge from Toronto, joined by Marcus Butler of Toronto and Bromley Armstrong from Toronto, Dr. John Harwood from Ottawa, Eric Mansfield from Montreal, and yours truly from Halifax. Over the last year, the committee has attempted to consult with various individuals and groups in the black community to deal principally with two major areas of concern. The first relates to the structure and overall organization of the National Black Coalition. At this year's conference, a constitutional proposal for the organization will be discussed and hopefully approved by those in attendance. The second area of concern for the committee was the establishment of a meaningful program of activities for the National Black Coalition. This program would be based on feedback and information obtained from various groups and individuals across the country, indicating the kinds of programs that it was felt that the National Black Coalition of Canada should occupy itself in. I'll give you, for the benefit of people who might want to attend the conference, I'll take a few minutes now to run down the program. The theme of the program is entitled Organizing for the 1980s, and as I've mentioned, the meetings will commence on Friday evening, November 2nd, 1979, at 7:30 p.m. in the Guild Hall of the Holiday Inn on Roby Street. There will be a opening banquet at that time. The Honorable John Buchanan, Premier of Nova Scotia, will be in attendance to address the delegates. Dr. Wilson Head, who has been the chairman of the interim executive of the NBCC this past year, will also speak to those in attendance at that time. On Saturday, November 3rd, the program gets into the nitty-gritty business sessions. Registration starts at 9 a.m. in the morning, and at 9:30 sharp, the floor will be opened up for constitutional discussions. At this time, it's hoped that the Constitution will be ratified by those in attendance. I might add that registration for the conference is $5, and the conference is open to all who might wish to attend. The morning program will occupy itself with a discussion of the Constitution. Then we'll break for lunch at 12:15 and come back at 1:30, at which time we'll commence discussions concerning program recommendations and resolutions. George McCurdy, the director of the Nova Scotia Human Rights Commission, will chair this session. At this time, there'll be a ratification of the proposed program of activities, which is based on feedback received from various individuals and groups from across the country. And in addition, a number of resolutions concerning international, national, and regional concerns will be discussed and debated at this time. The afternoon program will be followed by a banquet on Saturday evening in the Guildhall once again, starting at 7:30 p.m. Judge Stanley Grisell of Toronto, who is a citizenship judge in Toronto, will chair this session. And as part of this program, a special award will be given to former Executive Secretary of the NBCC, Roy Wellington States, who was formerly from New Glasgow and has lived in Montreal for some years now. A very special item on Saturday night as part of the program as well will be an address that will be delivered by Lewis J. Carter III, who is the National Labor Director of the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People in New York. Mr. Carter has been communicating with the National Black Coalition for the last year, and both organizations are hopeful that a working relationship can develop between the National Black Coalition of Canada and the NSAACP in the United States. On Sunday, we'll get into reports of the NBCC interim committees, the budget or a proposed budget for the NBCC activities over the next year will be presented. Also, Wilson Head, who's been chairman of the committee, will present a summary of the activities of the committee to the delegates at this point in time. Also, on Sunday morning will be the election of officers for the National Black Coalition of Canada. The National Black Coalition, as I mentioned at the top of the program, has been operating with an interim set of officers for the last year, and everyone is hopeful that after the Sunday program, the organization will be able to go forward with a new slate of officers. I'd like to go back and mention some of the considerations that have been taken place, or some of the considerations that have had a bearing in terms of the constitutional proposal that has been prepared for consideration by the delegates. The Constitutional Committee, headed by Dr. Ralph James of Winnipeg and Howard McCurdy of Windsor, is a fairly extensive document, and in striking the document, a number of considerations were taken into account by the Constitutional Committee. The first of these considerations was the fact that there should indeed be a National Black Organization, and that this National Black Organization should be the National Black Coalition of Canada. At some point, there was some consideration given to the possibility disbanding the National Black Coalition of Canada and attempting to structure a new organization. However, this was rejected by the committee, and the Constitution has been revised, and the National Black Coalition of Canada, the name of the National Black Coalition of Canada, has been retained. The Constitution also takes into consideration that although the National Black Coalition of Canada has had its up and downs since its formation, that the problems encountered by the National Black Coalition have essentially been problems that are not structural or constitutional in nature, but rather are of human origin, and that no organization, regardless of the constitution that it has, can function properly if the procedures set down in the Constitution are habitually ignored, as they have been in the past. Nonetheless, there was a feeling that the Constitution of the NBCC did need some revision to bring it up to date with modern-day realities. One of the considerations that figured very prominently in the drafting of the revised Constitution was the fact that there were the feeling that the structure of the NBCC should be such that it would not be detrimental to local organizations which have the same aims and objectives as the National Black Coalition of Canada. We have to be careful to take into consideration the fact that there are effectively functioning black organizations across the country at the moment, and that these organizations would have to be brought together in such a way that there would be no conflict of interest or conflict between the national organization and these local structures. It was also felt that there should be opportunity for individuals to belong to the National Black Coalition of Canada through vehicles other than local organizations to which they cannot or may not wish to belong. In the West, particularly where the black communities tend not to be as organized as they are in the East and West Coasts, it was felt that some mechanism should be provided for these individuals to join the National Black Coalition other than through organizations which in this case may or may not exist. Also, it was felt that a procedure should be clearly spelled out for local organization participation in the elections and policy decisions of the National Black Coalition of Canada. It was also felt that a proper procedure should be specified in the Constitution to allow for the orderly election of officers so that sufficient time is allowed for information to be circulated across the country so that people can make their decisions based on a reasonable and informed assessment of the choices available from among qualified candidates. A point that has occupied and taken up a considerable amount of discussion by the committee is the question of how any national organization should be funded. And it was strongly felt, and we felt it should be constitutionally mentioned and emphasized, that if the NBCC is to be self-sufficient and not find itself relying on government funding, then we felt it was absolutely necessary that member organizations and individuals who belong to the NBCC should make a financial commitment that would ensure that the National Black Coalition of Canada has a financial base on which to carry out its day-to-day administration. It also was felt important that a mechanism be established to ensure that each individual person affiliated with the National Black Coalition be known to the national office in order that he or she may be kept sufficiently informed of the program of the National Black Coalition and, more importantly, participate effectively in the decision-making process. Another consideration was the need for the structuring of regional organizations that could be formed with the consent of the majority of organizations in a particular region, and that once these regional organizations were formed, they should function in such a manner that it would ensure democratic participation of its constituent groups. It was also felt that any regional organizations established should have a clear working agreement between themselves and the national body about the distribution of powers and responsibilities in order to minimize possible areas of conflict between the two. The regional organizations also should have a very clear agreement on the financial commitment between itself and the national organization for fundraising purposes. And also, it was felt that embedded in any constitutional proviso should be the potential for the organization to evolve into a structure that would be more appropriate in meeting the needs of the black community than has been the case in the past. The constitutional proposal has been circulated widely across the country to people on the mailing list of the National Black Coalition of Canada, individuals who may be interested in participating in the constitutional discussions on Saturday morning, who have not received a copy of the constitutional proposal and would like to have one, could obtain a copy by contacting the offices of the Black United Front. Our amendments to the Constitution is circulated will be accepted up until 11 p.m. on Friday evening, November 2nd. That's the opening night of the conference. All amendments to the Constitution must be in writing, and individuals are asked to give the amendments to Howard McCurdy of the Constitutional Committee. And one item as well that may be of interest is the nominations for officers for the National Black Coalition of Canada. Individuals who would wish to make nominations for the various positions that will be up for election at the conference may do so, again, by providing these nominations prior to 11 p.m. on Friday evening, November 2nd. Nominations must be supported by two individuals in addition to the person making the nomination. The nominations also must have an indication from the person nominated that they would be prepared to accept a nomination to whatever office. And also, nominations must have a complete statement of qualifications on the individual being nominated. This should include details of the individual's educational background, as well as some indication of his or her community and work experience. No additional nominations for the positions will be accepted at the conference after 11 p.m. on Friday night, November 2nd. In addition to nominations which might come from the floor in this way, a nominating committee has been struck, and they will be presenting their nomination report at the meeting on Sunday morning. The offices that are up for election at this meeting will be the offices of chairman of the National Black Coalition, two vice chairmen, and a treasurer. And in addition, there will be nominations for five regional representatives. The regions would be the Maritime or Atlantic region, the Quebec region, the Ontario, the Prairie, and the Far West regions. At the conference, all individuals registering for the conference who will pay a $10 voting fee will be able to participate in the elections. The individuals must pay at the time of registration the $10 fee, whereupon they'll be provided with a credential, a form indicating that they're eligible to vote in the elections. Persons who do not wish to pay the voting fee may attend the business sessions and sit in on the elections and speak, but will not be able to vote. Organizations wishing to send delegates to vote on behalf of their organizations will also be required to pay a $10 voting fee for each of their delegates. Also, it will be necessary for organizations wishing to have voting delegates to fill out a delegate credential form. These forms, if you don't have them, again, are obtainable from the office of the Black United Front. Organizations may nominate delegates to the conference based on the number of members in their particular organization. Organizations with memberships between 10 and 25 members are eligible to nominate one delegate. From 25 to 150 affiliated members, two delegates, and with more than 150 affiliated members, three delegates. The voting weight attached to the delegate votes shall be 4-1. In other words, each delegate, organizational delegate's vote will be counted as four votes, whereas individuals' votes will only be counted as one. Delegates, I should stress that delegates for organizations will not be able to vote unless they bring a properly completed credential form along with the appropriate voting fee and pay the proper fee at the time of registration. In closing our program off for today, we'd like to take this opportunity to encourage all of the viewers of the Black Horizon program to join us in this very important national conference. The Black community in many ways is at a crossroads, and we have many important decisions that we must make if we're to be successful in organizing the community to address the needs of the Black community in the 1980s. We feel that it's important that we hear from a good cross-section of the local community in these deliberations. As I mentioned at the top of the program, we've carried out quite extensive consultations across the country, but nonetheless, we still feel it's important for individuals to make their point of view known. So we'd like to encourage you to come out and join us at the conference. The location, once again, will be at the Holiday Inn, 1980 Roby Street. The dates are November 2nd to 4th, 1979. The conference starts on Friday evening, November the 2nd, and finishes on Sunday, November the 4th. We look forward to seeing all of you there at that time. That's our program for Black Horizons today. Thank you for watching. See you next time. Hello, welcome to another program of Black Horizons. I'm your host, Hamid Rasheed. This afternoon I have with me two guests. They'll be talking about concerning the 9th annual meeting and conferences held this weekend past for the Black United Front. Before we turn to our guests, however, we want to deal with the Black Horizons community news first. Those of you who've been watching our program in the weeks past know that we've instituted two regular features now as part of our Black Horizons program. The first is what we're calling Man in the Street interviews. We're encouraging our viewers to send us suggestions of topics or areas of interest that you'd like for us to cover in our Man in the Street interviews. We have not been overwhelmed to this point by suggestions. However, we would encourage you to send any suggestions that you might have to the address that we'll be giving you in a moment during the community news section. Our next Man in the Street interview program will take place on the 25th of October, so if you have suggestions, please let us know right away. In the news this week, on October 13th, there will be a pre-Christmas tea and sale in the North Preston Community Center. Also on Saturday, October 13th, the BYF of the African United Baptist Association will present a play entitled The Road is Rough at Graham Creighton High School. The tickets are 75 cents for children, 12 and under, and $1.75 for all others. This play gives the history of the founding of the African United Baptist Association. On Monday evening, October 15th, 1979, at 7:30 in the evening, the Association of Black Social Workers will hold a meeting at the Dartmouth Library. All interested social workers in the Halifax-Dartmouth area, and indeed throughout the province, are invited to attend this meeting. On October 30th, the annual meeting of the Nova Scotia Home for Colored Children will be held at the home facilities at 7:30 p.m. Students in the East Preston area enrolled in non-degree or vocational programs who require financial assistance are asked to contact Mr. James Brindley of the Layman's Council of the East Preston Church before October 20th, 1979. The East Preston ratepayers are also looking for a person to act as the corresponding secretary. Anybody in East Preston who'd be interested in offering in this capacity is asked to contact Matthew Thomas or Althea Tolliver of the Ratepayers Association. Those are our items of news and notices for this week. If you have suggestions that you'd like to make to us, either for the Man in the Street interviews or for community news or notices, please send this information to Black Horizons Community News, care of Dartmouth Cable 10, Post Office Box 1011, Dartmouth, Nova Scotia. This weekend, the Black United Front held its 9th annual meeting and seminars in Halifax. The theme of the conference was The Black Family, A Key to an Orderly Society. As part of the program for this meeting, there were two workshop sessions. The first, held in the morning, was a workshop dealing with the crisis of the black family. The afternoon workshop was entitled The Black Family in Education. We have with us on our program Castor Williams, Halifax solicitor, who participated in the afternoon workshop on the black family in education. His topic was vocational horizons. We also have as our guest Wanda Thomas Bernard, who participated in the morning workshop session, and she talked on the crisis in the black family from the woman's perspective. We're going to talk to you both and perhaps share with the viewers of Black Horizons some of your concerns that you raised as part of the your presentation as panelists in these workshop sessions. First of all, Cass, going to you. You opened your remarks by saying the black community is at a crossroads. We have many options that are open to us. We are in a situation where we have to make choices. The kinds of choices that we make may very well determine the destiny of future generations. Could you tell us what you meant?
By that comment, what generally I was aiming at was that today we are living in a complex society, and in the future the society will become even more complex. And we as individuals, and even as a group, have to sit back and consider where we are as far as the total community is concerned and where we propose to go. And by that I mean that there are many, many things which we can do. For example, we can sit back and just not rely upon getting ourselves better educated. We can go into areas or avenues of experiences where we just have nothing at all happening to us, or we can sit down and we can educate ourselves and have our children educated and then proceed along those particular paths which will lead us to a better educated group and at the same time achieving better economic and other benefits.
I see. So then what you're really trying to do, I guess, was to alert the community to the need to begin to become active participants, so to speak, in terms of shaping their own...
In shaping their own destiny and in making themselves more aware of the problems that may exist in the future if nothing is done today about them.
Right. In terms of that process, you went on to say as part of your remarks that every man should understand the circumstances which have shaped him. I guess you're meaning by that each man should understand his history. To what extent do you think the history of the black man in this particular province has equipped him to become involved in the kind of analytical, I suppose, planning-oriented approach that you're suggesting?
Well, it seems to me from what I have been able to observe that the black man here may have to allow himself not to allow himself the luxury, so to speak, of not educating himself, because the past history seems to have indicated that the education which he received did not allow him to participate in the mainstream adequately of the society. And consequently, by saying that he must be aware of his own circumstances, is trying to impress that he has to consider everything that affects him in the society, and at the same time to consider and to rationalize or to see how those things which surround him and which he experiences affects the position which he holds today in the society and how it will affect him in the future.
Right. You went on to say that it's very important for the community to develop a philosophy and a plan regarding education if we're going to be able to survive as a race, and also to be able not only to survive but to be able to function. I think you put special emphasis on this whole question of function. What caused you to make that particular comment?
Again, what caused me to make that comment is the same things that I have observed, in that in order to be successful or to achieve anything, one has to have in his mind a philosophy or a goal, some sort of idea that keeps coming to his forefront, that makes him keep going along to achieve. And it seems to me that if the society in general doesn't have some sort of a goal, a philosophy, an idea of what they want to do or what they want to achieve or what they want to see happen to them in the future, then it seems to me that if that does not occur, that the society will not achieve anything of any great value. It's just as if a man without a vision, you know, if you don't have a vision of what you want to do or how you're going to achieve it, you will not really get up and go about doing it.
Mm-hmm. What kinds of trends can you foresee in the future that the black community should be taking into consideration now in terms of coming up with the philosophy, the plan that you speak of?
Well, first of all, it would seem to me that the leaders of the community and organizations that purports to assist in the development of the black community in all levels must be able to work together to develop a strategy of development, a strategy that will involve not only the educational front, but also the economic, political, and other areas in which the black people must and should be involved in. And until that sort of a total developmental plan is sort of a put on the table or mapped out and executed, then the whole idea of thrusting ahead and going forward into, as I indicated, the 21st century will not be really of great achievement or of great impact upon the black community and the community in general if the leaders and organizations do not get together and make some sort of a plan and disseminate or give out the philosophy of what they really have in mind for the black community.
I found it interesting when you were making your remarks, you put them in the context of where will we be in the 21st century? Where will the black community be functional? Will it be an underprivileged class, or will it be competing? In terms of looking down the road to the 1980s and 1990s, what kinds of, I guess what I'm trying to get to is the kinds of trends, the kinds of situations that you see existing in those times that we ought to be able to predict now, and we ought to be able to take cognizance of in terms of preparing the plan that you speak of.
Okay.
For example, what kinds of things do you see happening with the economy in the context of your presentation on vocational horizons? What kinds of jobs are there likely to be available in, say, 1980s, 1990s? 1980s is just around the corner, really.
Okay, if we take them one at a time, it seems to me that we are becoming more technological in our approach to life. And that being the case, the community, the black community, have to be aware that the future is one of technology. And because that will be so, to encourage within the system or educational system which the black children will be involved in, to be trained in the areas of technology that would be in vogue or would be prevalent in the, say, the 1980s and the up to the 21st century. For example, in areas of computer science, areas of, say, if you look around and see what the needs of the general society would be, as, for example, in mining, engineering, and maybe in other skills that will involve, high technical training. If we do not prepare today, in the 21st century, we'll be not be able to be in the mainstream as we are today of the total society.
Two comments that impressed me when you were talking about the or forecasting the kinds of occupations that are likely to be available. One was this question of the time it takes to prepare professionals. I think you were throwing out a word of caution to the community. Could you elaborate on that point for our viewers?
What I indicated then was that it takes approximately, say, 7 years to be a fully trained lawyer or to be a fully trained doctor. And I threw out to the community that they should consider the time involved in training professionals and also consider the time span which we have between today and the 21st century, and also to look at the stock of what we have in these type of professions. How many blacks do we have, say, as doctors? How many blacks do we have, say, as lawyers, accountants, engineers? And to consider that these are the type of professions that will be in demand in the 21st century. And what do we have as far as numbers of these professions are concerned? And how many of us are involved today either in training or as actual practitioners in these fields? And I also endeavor to point out that unless vocational goals are planned and streamlined to meet the needs and the demands of the future, then we will be in a very sad plight or a very sad state when the demands cannot be met and we'll still be in a stagnant and poverty-stricken position.
Do we have enough time as a black community, realizing that the year 2000 is only 20 or 21 years away, do we in fact have enough time to be able to develop the kinds of skills that you speak of? If you consider that a child that's born this year will be 21 in the year 2000, that pretty well suggests that we have to, those people who are now already in the stream, so to speak, are going to have to take particular note of the concerns that you raised. Do you think we've got enough time to take advantage? You know, given the fact that the knowledge and the kinds of changes that are coming into our civilizations are occurring at such breakneck speed, do you think the black community will be able to catch up?
Time is on this, is on your side if you consider time as really a sort of a relevant situation where today, if you were to do a certain act, you may consider it as the starting point. And if you say that in the year 2000 will be the finishing act, then you can consider that span as a time limit in which you have to accomplish a certain thing. But it seems to me that in this type of situation in which I am projecting, is that time is not a factor per se. What is really required is a start. And once you are aware of what the problems are, and you start, and you acknowledge that the problems do exist, and you enter into a kind of a determination to overcome these problems, then time, I feel, is on your side. Because once you are on the road, time then becomes irrelevant, because you are going to achieve. And once you're achieving, you will have at the same time to sort of develop or to encourage as much of your population or much of your group to also become involved, and so that when you reach to, say, the 21st century, if you do not have the finished product, at least you will have the product on the way.
I see. What about the argument that could be put forward by, I suppose, young people who are involved in the education system now? Certainly education plays a major role in terms of developing the kinds of skills that you speak of. What about the arguments that the school system is incapable of developing the kinds of skills that you talk about, that the education system is a mechanism for human resource development, really is failing the black kid? The curriculum is not relevant.
all of the accusations I'm sure you've heard made about the education system, mm-hmm. racism, for example, in the education system. How can you reconcile the two positions? On the one hand, the need that I think everybody has to agree with to try to develop the kinds of skills in order to be able to compete, and on the other hand, an education system which apparently doesn't seem to be developing those kinds of skills, at least in as much as the black community is concerned.
Well, here I feel is where the community leaders and the, and I understand there is a black education and group. Here it is where I feel that it is their role to get involved in the sort of activities which I have mentioned and to approach the powers that be in their own discretion on what they feel is good for a strategy of education development, and approach the powers that be to develop the sort of programs which I have indicated. I'm not an educationist, not involved in the education field itself, so I would not really have any great depth or insight into the mechanism of the educational system, and all you has indicated to me would be hearsay as far as I'm concerned.
So certainly, as any part of a strategy, it has to involve some kind of approach to make the education system more relevant.
I would believe so. I would say so, yeah.
Right. In your closing remarks, I'm afraid that your legal training came in. You referred to the verdict. What the verdict would be in terms of our children looking back in the year 2000 and determining whether or not they would find us guilty of procrastination, indecision, and apathy. What do you think will be the result if the black community does not heed your advice, does not develop a plan, and continues along the vein that it has heretofore? What do you think the situation will be in the year 2000?
Well, I think the verdict will be guilty. And I also feel that if we do not take that sort of stand or take that position and to plan ahead, I think that in the 21st century, we may find ourselves to be the permanent poor of the society and not able to function adequately in terms of economic power, political power, or any kind of power. We may find ourselves relegated to the backwash of the society and to perpetuate the myth that we are unwanted and we are no good group of people who cannot really do anything or contribute anything to the general society. So I feel that if we want to break away from the so-called pattern of poverty, it is up to us to understand and to take the bull by the horn, so to speak, and plan our own destiny so that we can truly be masters of our destiny.
We have about 10 minutes left in the program, and before we close off, we don't want to be accused of being male chauvinists here, so we want to turn to Wanda now and talk about your participation, Wanda, in the conference on the panel dealing with the crisis in the black family. We were just talking to Cass in terms of the economic situation. I think you made a statement that the lack of economic base has devastating effects on the family. Could you share with our viewers what your thoughts were in that regard, how economics have an impact on the family?
I was looking at it from a historical perspective, and my view of it was that the economic situation has driven the female into the workforce. Historically, our black men have not been able to secure full-time, meaningful employment. Therefore, the female has had to go out and work. Subsequently, I think this situation has prevailed till today. Many black females are required to work full-time or part-time, and this does really make a change in the family itself in terms of family unity and so on.
What kinds of effects, if we could just pursue this a bit more, it seems that a lot of people in the larger community today are putting forward the cause for women to be able to go into the job market, to be able to become career people, and I hear you saying that that may not necessarily be a good thing, that there are some adverse effects, at least in the black context. Could you share with us some of the adverse effects that grow out of the woman perhaps having to become career-oriented or having to take a job? What kind of impact does that have on the black family?
In the black family, because of the economic situation, the female for the most part, has been the sort of head of the household. And in that respect, in terms of her relationship with the children, if she has to go outside the home, take a full-time job, that cuts down on the amount of time that she has available in the home with the children in terms of direct contact with them. So that in itself, I see that as presenting a change in the family.
You made an interesting comment in terms of the psychological effect on the families where the female is able to secure employment, but the male is unable to secure employment. Could you comment on the psychological effects of that kind of situation?
With females being head of the household, major decision makers, the one holding the family together and so on, I think this has devastating effects on the black male. Really blows his ego. He feels that the woman is being domineering, overpowering. Quite often the female is forced into this position. She has to persevere on. Most times she really doesn't want to be domineering, but someone has to go on and sort of hold the family together and keep working for the benefit of the family.
And going back again to these things are all interrelated, the education, the economic, the family, the relationship between them, it's a particular kind of thing. But you also made the comment, I believe, in your remarks that because of economics, oftentimes children drop out of education early.
Well, most black families find it extremely difficult financially to keep their children in school, especially when they get to the high school level. So, you know, if 16-year-old John comes home and says, I want to quit school, I don't feel I can go on, quite often they'll come home and say, I have a job. Now, it might be a job making, you know, $2.75 an hour, but quite often that is so necessary as to add to the family income that they will condone this, and they'll say, okay, you know, you can quit school and you can work. And then subsequently they add to the family budget, and it's needed. So it's, on the one hand, parents don't want their kids to quit school. They want the best for the children. They want the children to get better education than they themselves had. But on the other hand, if they're faced with a situation, it's either we eat today or we don't sort of thing, then they will certainly condone the child leaving school.
I also, though, I think I may have detected a little bit of a tone of condemnation in your remarks on the weekend when they were delivered. I think you, maybe I got you wrong, but I seem to hear you be perhaps being a little bit critical maybe of parents allowing the children to drop out of school because of economic reasons. Was I correct in my reading of that?
I was being critical not of the family. I don't think we should criticize parents without recognizing the fact that society itself has an important role here. And if the economic conditions in the community itself were better, then maybe that would help alleviate the financial burdens on the family. Therefore, they wouldn't be forced into a position where they would have to make a compromise and a sacrifice, mm-hmm. which we've historically have done for years.
Mm-hmm. Going back now to the question of the family and education in terms of parents and black people recognizing the importance of education, I think you made the point that black parents oftentimes lack awareness of just what's happening with their children in the school and the kinds of programs that the children are involved in.
There's a definite gap between the parent, the child, and the school. Most parents have no awareness about what's happening in the school with the children, and I think parents have to become involved. I can appreciate that most parents feel very threatened about going to the school, especially in situations where they'll be hearing negative comments about their children. There has to be something done to bridge this gap. Now, maybe this is, and I'm a social worker, so I'm probably speaking from a socialist point of view, but I think social workers could become involved here and could help bridge that gap between the parent and the school. The school usually takes the attitude, labeling the parent. If parents don't come to the school, if they don't phone in, they're not interested. Quite often the parent is interested but is threatened about showing that interest, and are not all that comfortable in going and meeting the professionals at the school. So I think we in the black community, I think black leaders should be looking at working with parents and creating a better awareness of just what their role has to be in terms of, as Mr. Williams mentioned earlier, everyone needs a goal to work towards. I think for young people, the parents have to help them establish goals for themselves and then do everything in their power to meet those goals. And I think in the black community, we have to work with parents to help them recognize and work at their end of the bargain.
We unfortunately have
just about run out of time. There's one other area that I want to explore with you before we do conclude our program today. I hope that our viewers will not... we really perhaps didn't devote as much time as perhaps ought to have devoted to this whole question of the black family. But generally speaking, in terms of the crisis in the black family, would you say that the black family is progressing or regressing, or is it holding its own? Is there, in fact, a crisis in the black family?
I think there is. I think we are regressing. Black families are not as close and unified as they used to be. And I think if we as a black community, as a family of black people, are going to go ahead into the 21st century, then I think there's a lot of work to be done with the family in terms of keeping the family intact. And I see the family unit as the major unit in terms of working towards our place in the future.
Well, that's our program for the day. I'm afraid we've run out of time. We may perhaps sometime in the future have you back, Wanda, and go into more detail in terms of this whole question of the crisis in the black family. It's an area that I'm sure is of interest to the viewers of the Black Horizons program. Unfortunately, however, all good things must come to an end. That's our program for today. Thank you for watching Black Horizons. See you next time.